Let's see where the differences are. And if they seem to be intractable, let's rejoice in that. I think from the beginning in the civil rights movement, let's say, and right up to today, all of our work has been ecumenical, and I think at a very deep level, and has encompassed, let's say, a peaceable grouping of people who didn't want murder to be legal, and who were agreed at least on that, and a lot of other things too, and who could walk together in the direction of vulnerable lives and protect those people, even though we came from all sorts of religious backgrounds. So I think the differences tended to be mitigated, not dissolved, but mitigated in practice, you know? That is to say, when we saw somebody or many, many people endangered, we could at least stand there and utter a common outcry. And that wasn't bad. That wasn't bad faith.
I'm Bernadette Price. I'm the associate publisher of Orbis Books in Maryknoll, New York. And I am welcoming you on behalf of our publisher, Robert Ellsberg, who's unable to be here, and all of the folks at Orbis and Maryknoll Bobs and Brothers, our parent. This is a very special day. It's been long in the planning, and I want to say a quick thank you to Savina Clark and her sister, Kathleen. Thank you, and a quick thank you to the Villanova Center for Peace and Justice Education, who gave us this space gratis, and it's a beautiful space. I'm glad to have it. I'm pleased to introduce now Bobby Darabin's biographer and friend, Jim Forrest, native of New Jersey. He's been a writer since the age of five and an activist nearly as long. He left school at age 17 to join the Navy, then entered the Catholic Church in 1960, and got himself honorably discharged, early discharged, as a conscientious objector, if you see any relationship between one and the other. He's been a journalist and editor, as well as the author of more than a dozen books, including biographies of Thomas Merton, Dorothy Day, and Gerald Berrigan. In 1965, he founded the Catholic Peace Fellowship and was imprisoned as one of the Milwaukee 14 for burning draft records. In 1977, he moved to Holland to head up the staff of the International Fellowship of Reconciliation, and he served as its general secretary until 2012. He's lectured in the US and England and is a recipient of a number of awards, including most recently the Louis from the International Merton Society in 2017. Welcome, Jim.
Pleasure to be here. I hope you can hear me because
yes.
I have a touch of Parkinson's, and one of the things they can do is affect your voice. So if you don't hear me, it's not because I'm not speaking. It's especially good to be here with Jim Carroll, who whose friendship goes back to the deepest roots in my life as a peace worker and as an attempted writer. Such a joy to open my eyes in the lobby of the hotel where we're staying and discover I was looking at Jim again. It's been a long time. I first met Dan Berrigan in 1961, thanks to Dorothy Day. Dorothy brought me with her to a small apartment in Harlem at which Dan presented a paper on social teaching and the impact of John the 23rd. Dan was introduced to us as a poet, the poet who had won the Lamont Poetry Prize and was currently teaching New Testament studies at Le Moyne College, a Jesuit school in Syracuse, New York. I didn't see him again until a few years later, June 1964, when he and I were participants in a traveling seminar that went from New York to Paris to Rome to Prague, where we were going to take part in what at the time was a remarkable attempt to bring Christians together across the Iron Curtain, from Russia, from other countries in Eastern Europe, from the West, from the United States, to talk about the theology of peacemaking. So we were suddenly traveling together across Europe, aiming at this ecumenical conference in Prague. Dan was already in Paris when we arrived there, our first stop. And at the time, chaplain. He was chaplain of a group of students at St. Severin Parish on the left bank. I asked him what had brought him from Syracuse to France. It was due, he said, to his liturgical innovations, saying Mass in English well before that sort of thing was officially authorized. Also, his engagement in local civil rights movement activities jeopardized contributions to the university from donors whose business practices resembled those of the unreformed Ebenezer Scrooge. These impolitic activities had caused tension between him and the college administration. After 6 years teaching theology at Le Moyne, Dan had been given a year-long sabbatical in France. A sugar-coated exile, Dan commented. Oh, what a place to be. We traveled on together from Paris to Rome, then to Prague. One night in Prague, the several Catholics participating in the seminar resolved to found, on our return to America, a group we christened the Catholic Peace Fellowship. Our main goal would be to organize Catholic opposition to the Vietnam War, which was then in its early stages as far as America was concerned, defense having withdrawn after defeat at the Battle of Dien Bien Phu. Our main goal would be to organize Catholic opposition to the Vietnam War then in its early stages, and then we would try to launch a national program to make the option of conscientious objection to war better known, and something that was not only for Quakers and people in so-called historic peace churches, but in the Catholic Church. Both of us, back in New York, Dan was assigned to be one of the editors of a magazine that no longer exists, Jesuit Missions. Monthly magazine. Meanwhile, I left my job as a journalist in a newspaper in New York to work full-time for the Catholic Peace Fellowship. Tom Cornell, another former editor of the Catholic Worker, soon joined me. Beginning in January 1965, the three of us normally met once a week in Dan's one-room apartment. We had Mass together, very informal. And then went on to discuss letters the CPF had received that week and decide on different aspects of our work, invitations to speak and so forth. How to respond to the worsening conflict in Vietnam was, of course, a major factor at every meeting. I returned to the United States, Dan later recalled, convinced of one simple thing, the war in Vietnam could only get worse. We Americans were about to repeat the already bankrupt experience of the French. I was afflicted with the sense that my life was being truly launched for the first time upon mortal and moral events. That might indeed overwhelm me as the tidal violence of world events churned into an even greater fury. I had a sense that this war would be my making or my breaking. One of the Catholic Peace Fellowship's significant initiatives of this period was publishing a book on Catholics and conscientious objection. I was the author, assisted very much by Dan as well as by Thomas Merton, editing and polishing the text. The orthodoxy of the booklet was certified by an imprimatur miraculously achieved from the Archdiocese of New York, Cardinal Spellman, you may recall. That booklet went through 300,000 copies. And it's surely one of the factors that helps explain why so many thousands of young Catholics refused to fight in Vietnam. Dan was, of course, pleased that the work of the Catholic Peace Fellowship was having a definite impact on building opposition to the war, but in 1968, to leap forward a few years, it was time not only for education and opposition, but in Dan's view and his brother Phil's, resistance. On the 17th of May, with his brother, seven others, nine altogether, he burned 378 draft records in a parking lot adjacent to a draft center in the Baltimore suburb of Catonsville. The event was headline news, and indeed the Catonsville Nine is still being talked about. Dan was nothing if not a writer. When he died in April 2016 at the age of 94, just a week or two short of 94, he left a legacy of more than 60 books of prose and poetry. But the text he's best known for is quite short, a two-page document in which he explained what led him to Catonsville. I'd just like to read a few extracts. "Our apologies, good friends, for the fracture of good order. The burning of paper instead of children. The angering of the orderlies of the front parlor of the charnel house. We could not, so help us God, do otherwise. For we are sick at heart. Our hearts give us no rest for thinking of the land of burning children. All of us who act against the law turn to the poor of the world, to the Vietnamese, to the victims, to the soldiers who killed and died for the wrong reasons or for no reason, or all because they were ordered to do so by the authorities. Authorities of that public order, which in effect is a massive institutionalized disorder. We say killing is disorder. Life and gentleness and community and unselfishness are the only order we recognize. For the sake of that order, we risk our liberty, our good name. How many must die before our voices are heard? How many must be tortured, dislocated, starved, maddened? How long must the world's resources be raped in the service of legalized murder? When, at what point, will you say no to this war? We've chosen to say with the gift of our lives, with the gift of our liberty, the violence stops here. The death stops here. The suppression of the truth stops here. This war stops here. Redeem the times. The times are inexpressibly evil. Christians pay conscious, indeed religious, tribute to Caesar and Mars. They embrace their society with all their heart and abandon the cross. They pay lip service to Christ and military service for the powers of death. Didn't realize how reading this again was so difficult. The nine defendants argued in court that attempts to impede an immoral and illegal war and to prevent the commission of war crimes should be seen as legally justified, like running a red light to get a gravely injured child to the hospital. Unfortunately, the court was unwilling to hear arguments that put war on trial. Though convicted and sentenced to 3 years confinement, for a time the nine were freed on bail while the judgment was being appealed. During that intermezzo of court-authorized freedom, Dan wrote a play based on the trial. It's something of a modern Greek drama in the tradition of Antigone. The script has become assigned reading in many classrooms. The play continues to be performed all over the world. Declining to exit the stage in order to begin serving his sentence as scheduled, the ever-theatrical Dan went underground. Sheltering in a Sherwood forest of friends and friends of friends, Dan led the FBI in a Robin Hood-like chase that lasted 4 months. Daniel Berrigan, Jesuit priest, poet, theologian, was placed on the FBI's 10 most wanted list. In the annals of crime in America, he is the only person ever promoted to that august rank who never possessed a deadly weapon or posed a threat to anyone's life. The wanted poster should have included a sentence, "This man is disarmed and dangerous." While in hiding, Dan did television and newspaper interviews, even preached in church one Sunday morning. I had a meeting with him one evening in an apartment a short walk from the FBI's Manhattan headquarters. Dan seemed to be available to anyone and everyone except FBI agents. Finally, he was found in handcuffs while staying with friends on Block Island. It takes a book to review all that happened in Dan's life, a remarkable journey in which the homeless, the gravely ill, those dying of AIDS, the unborn, all played a part. Dan taught in various schools and traveled widely. New books by him appeared every year. He was arrested over and over again for acts of protest. He said himself, I have no idea how many times. And in writing the biography, I tried to come up with a number. It's between 300 and 400. Dan's life was shaped by the conviction that God does not sanction killing, and that the way to heaven is the way of nonviolence and mercy. Now, if you want to take a closer look at his life, I highly recommend this biography of him, which is available today. I will not mention the author's name. But let me read an extract from the last chapter of the book. Dan was the target of sharp criticism through much of his adult life, but lived long enough to witness some validations. Not least of these, he saw a fellow Jesuit with a similar conscience, elected Pope, who took the name Francis. Linking his pontificate to the poor man of Assisi, who became a missionary of mercy and an enemy of war. He lived to hear the same Pope stand before both houses of Congress in Washington, D.C., and single out for praise two of Dan's principal mentors, Dorothy Day and Thomas Murray. Just months before Dan's heart stopped beating, the Vatican hosted a global meeting of peacemakers who proposed that it was time to bury the just war theory, the doctrine, and focus instead on nonviolent methods of conflict resolution and what makes for a just peace. In all 16 centuries of the just war theory, it was pointed out at the conference, no national hierarchy had ever condemned as unjust any war its nation's military was engaged in. Dan was one of those who has helped speed the day when Christians can no longer attach the adjectives just or holy to the word war. Dan was easy to love, but even late in his life, he was a challenging person to be with. Well, he wasn't a recruiting sergeant. He wasn't a recruiting sergeant in the sense that he didn't say, next action's coming, you, Sabine, is going to be in it. He made it clear to all who encountered him that the possibility exists to reshape one's life around the beatitude of peacemaking. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they should be called children of God. Saying no to any death-centered activity is an integral part of such a commitment. Dan's life raised the question, as a step in the right direction, how about shaking the dust out of your life as with an act of protest, even a little civil disobedience now and then? Would a sabbatical in jail, even a brief one, be such a bad idea? In any event, get out of the tomb and make some gestures, however modest, that favor life. In my own case, Dan helped me to imagine taking a step, becoming one of the 14 people to burn draft records in Milwaukee in September 1968, a step that I might otherwise not have taken. I am in debt to Dan for nudging me over the cliff of my own fears. Dan had powerful convictions, but was not self-righteous. One of the things Dan showed me was that you don't have to wag a scolding finger at others in the effort to open the door to a more peaceful life. Accusations seldom change anyone's mind. Clerics do not convert. You can be as absolute as Dan about not killing anyone and at the same time enjoy the company of people who don't agree with you and probably never will. In his writing and lectures, Dan could be as unyielding on life and death issues as Moses with the tablets of the Ten Commandments. But in face-to-face encounters, he had an amazing gift to make space for and welcome the other, to tell stories and jokes, to create bridges of affinity and laughter. In Ireland, arguing the virtues of nonviolence with the leader of the Far From Nonviolent IRA, Dan realized how much he liked this person, despite their radically different views. It didn't make their differences less significant, or their verbal jousting less intense. But their mutual affection put a dimension of love into their relationship, into their exchange. Dan, like many others involved in anti-war protest, was often described as a peace activist. But it's worth noting that he was far from being a full-time activist, whatever that means. In one letter to me, he remarked that many good people are overworked and underjoyed. I hear a few nods of assent. He loved cooking and rarely ate alone. He enjoyed a glass of wine or two at the end of the day, or if a martini was available, so much the better. Daily walks were a major part of his spiritual life. I cannot recall Dan ever being in a hurry. Unless you're coming from somewhere, you're not going to get anywhere, he said from time to time. What that somewhere Dan was coming from is not easily described, but silence and sacrament were essential elements and helped keep him from being underjoyed. So were the works of mercy. In his case, most of all, being with the sick. A great deal of Dan's life was spent caring for the gravely ill. He became a listener of last resort to countless people dying of AIDS. One of Dan's great talents was friendship. He was a delight to be with, loved to have guests, loved to cook for them. Often enjoyed company on his daily walks. Listened closely and remembered what others had said. No small achievement. If a friend was in need, he often found a way to help. I remember trying to find the money to insulate the apartment I was living in at the time. It was leaking rain and cold air in the winter blowing through a gale force. Dan came up to me one afternoon and handed me a folded piece of paper, stuck it in my pocket. I opened it up, it was a check for $10,000, which was about what I needed to make this place more habitable. It was from some retreat he had left. As far as I know, Dan never kept any money. It just passed through his one person to another. I have known many people who live what one might call Jesus-shaped lives. Dorothy Day and Thomas Merton among them. Dan, certainly. Such people remind those who encounter them of the Gospels. These are people who in various ways, large and small, lay down their lives for their neighbor, including the hostile neighbor, the enemy. One can make no sense of the pivotal choices Dan made in his long life apart from the New Testament. In a conversation he and I were having one afternoon with a group of students, I recall Dan saying that everyone has a God, that life is impossible without some center point in one's life. One's micro-God might be national identity, an ideology, politics, science, a religious institution, a baseball team, a theory about health and the ideal diet. Might be celebrities, might be Hollywood, might be just about anything. But, Dan proposed, if you're going to have a God, it might as well be God. Capital G. And then the big project begins, the lifelong quest of finding who God is and why we exist. And why such great hopes have been placed upon us. The love of creation, the care of life. In contrast to his athletic brother Dan and Phil was certainly right off of Wheaties box, Dan didn't look like a warrior, but he was a brave man. Brave man. Not only in his many actions in opposing war and militarism, but in challenging his friends on issues about which they took a militant opposing view. Dan saw life whole from womb to deathbed and tried to inspire protection of life every inch of the way. Parting company with many friends, Dan had the courage to raise his voice on behalf of those tiny human beings awaiting birth, as well as the women who in various ways are being pushed toward abortion. Dan's commitment to the unborn was in part inspired by the gratitude and wonder awakened in him by the Eden-like beauty of children's faces. A beauty so often dull as we get older and as fears deform us. Such powerful fears as being out of step with one's peer group. More powerful than the selective service system, more powerful than any advertising campaign, more powerful than any political slogan, is peer group pressure. how often children figured in his writing, and how easily Dan connected with children. I recall how much he enjoyed playing with our own kids during his stays with us after my work brought me to Holland. In one of my favorite photos of him, he was playing catch with our five-year-old daughter, Caitlin, in the parking lot behind our house. As a house gift at the end of that visit, he left this poem. If war is about children, so is peace. We cannot put things off, put off peacemaking, any more than we can put off the discomforts of a child's hunger or thirst in favor of our own comfort. Here we are at this notable Jesuit institution, so it's appropriate to note one of the achievements of Dan's life is that somehow he remained a Jesuit. It was not always easy. He once sent me, a young man not even 30 at the time, to intercede for him with his provincial at a point when there was more than an even chance that Dan would be given the Jonah option as Dan would. That is to be thrown overboard. Following the Catonsville action and other less famous crimes and misdemeanors, many of his fellow Jesuits made their distaste for him and what he represented quite clear. In some cases, they even changed their mind. In a period when celibacy was regarded by many as an indication of mental illness, Dan remained a celibate and even managed to joke about it. I remember being with Dan at a student Christian conference in Sheffield, England, 1973. The question was raised by one student, Father Dan, would you please explain celibacy? Without missing a beat, Dan said, I am so sorry, I forgot to bring the celibacy slideshow with me. I bring quite a slideshow. Much laughter, but that was all the answer the questioner cried out of Dan. As I can bear witness, Dan was unjudgmental, even sympathetic, toward those whose sexual lives had gone off the church-sanctioned rails in various directions. But he personally stuck to celibacy. He once described it as sexual solitude. Like a barnacle on a ship's hull, though he had great compassion for those like myself who had failed in attempts at marriage, he tried to inspire fidelity and perseverance. In a letter I received from him, again, in 1973, Dan reminded me that he was a priest whom marriage is sacred, a sacrament, sealed in Christ's love. This is a very deep thing with me, faithful love. I have tried in my own life to take this course, with fits and starts, but in at least a clear vision of the summons, to be a sign of this. At the center of Dan's life was the Mass. Looking back over old journals while writing this book, I found these words. I kept journal after journal drawing pictures and writing down things that friends said or wrote. I found these words, celebrating bread, every fragment of which is a reminder of the Eucharistic bread. He wrote, when I hear the sound of bread breaking, I see something else. It seems almost as though God never meant to do anything else. So beautiful a sound. The crust breaks up like manna and falls all over everything, and then we eat. Bread gets inside us. Bread gets inside humans. His greatest gift may not have been the path he opened for so many people to accept certain actions. His greatest Eucharistic life and faith for people who have been estranged from almost everything. good is to be done because it is good, Dan said in an interview. Not because it goes somewhere. I believe that if it is done in that spirit, it will go somewhere. But I don't know where. I don't think the Bible grants us to know where goodness goes, what direction, what force. I have never been seriously interested in the outcome. I was interested in trying to do it humanly and carefully and nonviolently and let it go. We have not lost everything because we lost today. I get to the last paragraph, you'll be glad to know. My voice had its order. Once again, asked by a journalist who thought he was on the right track, Dan replied, "Well, I'm embarrassed when I compare what I am and what I should be." It was a modest response. Dan loved the word modesty and used it often. Be modest about what you are doing. Be modest in your expectations of what your act of witness will achieve. Be modest about who you are. Do your best, but get used to failure. It's God who made the world, and God who saves it. Not you, not me. But be confident that whatever you do to safeguard life is not wasted.